Hey everybody, Father Dominic here. I'm in our chapel here at the diocese, but I want to dig into the question today of what is that big book that's up on the altar during Mass? And you can see the one that we have here at our diocesan offices. Obviously there's different Catholic publishers that'll print these, and they're always just an imposing and a solemn book. You know, you'll see them, they'll be edged in gold with ribbons, everything, right? Because we want to give something that is proper to the worship of God. And that's where I want to start. You can see here that I have the page open to this first part of what's called the Roman Missal, right? The general instruction of the Roman Missal. It's a long phrase for this very first section, and this part is not something you're going to hear at Mass. This is the instruction manual for the rest of the Missal, so that the priest knows, he knows the different days and like whether a feast day would be on top of another feast day, right? Do you celebrate the Sunday Mass? Do you just celebrate the Solemnity Mass? What color would you wear? What are the proper places for standing, for sitting, for kneeling during the Mass? All of that's found in this general instruction, which starts us off, right? And I think there's something to be learned there. Not very many books in our lives we open up and there's an instruction manual at the beginning, right? 10% of this book is dedicated to properly preparing and properly knowing how to go about celebrating the Mass. And the Church is teaching us something important when she does that. She's teaching us the priority of when we go to Mass, we're sort of stepping outside of ourselves and into an offering to God, right? We call it the sacrifice of the Mass, because this is the representation, as it said, of Christ's sacrifice that he made in the upper room, on the cross, and in his resurrection, right? And so when we celebrate the Mass, we're stepping into that place where we're allowing ourselves to be caught up into this activity, this action, this offering of the whole Church back to God. That's the very first thing, is this is an offering to the Lord. This is an act of worship. That's why we have these instructions here, because the priest and the people, everyone involved is called to kind of align their lives, align themselves with these prayers, with the readings, with this offering to God that Christ offers first, and then the priest, and then the entirety of the Church. So we begin here. I'm not going to go through all the instructions, right? But just to start there with that thought of, oh, this is something that is asked of me. This is something I'm joining myself to. One key here, throughout the Missal, all throughout, you'll see, I'm just going to flip it open to a random page. Here we are in the middle of the Eucharistic prayers, and notice that there's little bits that are in red. These are called rubrics. These are the little bits of instructions that the priest gets as he's going through the Mass. So he doesn't have to flip back and forth, right? It's right there in front of him if he needs to invite people to stand, or if another concelebrant is going to step in for part of that prayer. It's called rubrics. You might notice that word has a similar sound, a similar root to the word ruby. It has to do with the red coloring, right? But I like that connection with the idea of a great treasure. These instructions, these rubrics, these little bits of information about how to go about celebrating the Mass kind of unlock the treasures of the Mass for us, right? And that's why we sort of we come to the Mass with a kind of humility towards what the Church is asking of us and what the Church is offering to God. We don't do this just however we want. The priest doesn't do it just however he wants. He's following these instructions given him by the Church so that all of us Catholics are joined to the same Mass, but also because the idea is that we're unlocking this treasure trove that God has entrusted to the Catholic Church. So I'll stop with that for now. From here on out, I want to just go through the Missal, the different main parts of it, and how a priest sets it up when he's in the sacristy before Mass. How do you figure out where the ribbons go, right? The very first major section of the Missal is called the Proper of Time. You'll notice that the very first thing here is the first Sunday of Advent. But as we flip through this, it's gonna continue on. We've got Advent, we've got Christmas, now we finally get into Lent. The way that it's set up is it does those major seasons before, after we finish through the Lent and Easter seasons, now it goes and it fills out all the different weeks of ordinary time. For a priest celebrating the Mass, this is probably gonna be the place he starts. If it's as this one is, right, Thursday of the first week of Lent, he's going to flip it open to Thursday of the first week of Lent and see what it says. These are the prayers that are specific to that day's Mass. The prayers that come in between all of these, the prayers that are standard for every single Mass, you know, the sign of the cross at the beginning, or the Confiteor, or the Lord have mercy, right? If there's a Gloria, or if there's a Creed, those things are all going to be found later on. But the priest starts here because it's going to give indications if he needs to look elsewhere for those other pieces. In this case, just notice, here we are, first week of Lent. It says the preface for this season of Lent can be found on page 546. So let's go to page 546. This, as you might notice, I have a ribbon here, is in what's called the order of Mass. Those are those common prayers that come at every Mass. In this case, we're going to 546. That's going to be in the middle of this section where we have prayers for that are standardized to all of the Masses. In this case, it's the preface. Preface, of course, comes before one of the Eucharistic prayers. We have a different video digging into those. But you can see where, if the priest starts here, that gives him an indication like, oh, okay, if I set my first ribbon here, because I'm gonna start the Mass here with the entrance antiphon and then the opening prayer eventually, then I'm also going to want a ribbon on this page, because after the offertory prayer, I'm going to want to flip to the preface before I get on further along to the Eucharistic prayers. Once again, there's four major Eucharistic prayers and then the additional ones as well. This is where, though, we've got a little bit of a curveball, because notice we had that whole proper of time, and that's going week by week, first week of Advent, you know, up through Christmas season, up through Lent, up through Easter, right? But there's also an entire section after you get through these ordinary parts of the Mass. You then have the proper of saints. You guys all know this, but there's also that calendar of saints' feast days throughout the year, right? And this is where it can get a little bit tricky, because if you're on the Thursday of the fourth week of Lent, and it's also, I'm going to come up with an example. I don't know that this overlaps this year, but the Solemnity of St. Joseph, right, in March. Okay, the Solemnity takes precedence, right? And so the priest would, instead of flipping to that day on the week, right, the saint day on that particular occasion would sort of trump the ordinary kind of cadence of days of the calendar. And that's where the priest would then flip instead. Let's see if I can find St. Joseph here quickly. All right, hang on, there we go. St. Joseph, March 19th. You can see this is a Solemnity, right? So Solemnity is always going to trump those other days. In this case, we've even got a Gloria. Now, usually during the season of Lent, you're not going to see the Gloria, right? You're not going to sing it, because Lenten is a more somber season, right? You're not going to have the Gloria. But in this case, St. Joseph sort of lifts us out of Lent almost, and we get a Gloria on his feast day. So in this case, the priest would start here, and these would sort of replace or kind of take the place of those other possible prayers. I'll add one last thing. At the end of the Missal, there's a whole set of appendices that have different prayers. These can be prayers for specific occasions, like a ritual Mass for religious profession, right? Or for a confirmation Mass or for an ordination. This is also where, if the priest is doing like a Mass for the dead, you'd find here's the prayers for a Mass for a deceased priest, right? So you have whole sections devoted to the different Masses that can be offered for a particular intention or for a particular kind of purpose. But I want to flip all the way back past these appendices, and there's some prayers at the back of the Missal that the Church offers to the priest to say before or after Mass. Notice these beautiful prayers. Here's one from St. Thomas Aquinas to be said in preparation for Mass. Here's one from St. Ambrose, same thing. There's also ones for after offering the Mass again. Pope Clement XI, there's like dozens of these different prayers. I simply finish us there because I think that time that the priest is setting the Missal ahead of time is not just meant to like get the ribbons in the right place, right? Same for us. When we show up at the Mass, the goal is not simply to get ourselves in the pew, get ourselves situated, and sort of be ready to go, right? The idea is to kind of prepare ourselves spiritually as well. The priest is encouraged to read through the prayers so that he knows what he's praying. And we can do the same in the missalettes that we have in our pews, or if you have a missal, or if you just have a phone and you pull up the readings and the prayers for that day. You can read through those and reflect on them beforehand or after Mass, right? Go back. Was there one word that caught your attention when the priest was doing the opening prayer, when he was singing the preface? There was something there, there's a line there that caught your attention. Go back to that. These are beautiful prayers that the Church offers, And we don't want to just, again, that idea of a treasury, right? We don't want to just sort of like, wow, that's great, and then leave the gift behind, right? But to actually carry that with us. One priest one time, he coined the phrase, the liturgical providence of God. The idea being, every single day, we've got these different prayers that the church offers, these different readings that the church gives to us, right? And there's a providence there. There's a way that God has offered those things to us. I'm sure you've had the occasion where you've gone to Mass, and something has struck you, and you're like, ah, I needed to hear that right now, right? All of us have been there, and we don't want to miss those gifts, right? When something sticks out to us, let's hold on to that. Let's carry that through our week, right? Let's carry that through our day. That's a gift, that's a treasure from the Lord that's been abundantly kind of poured forth into His church, into the Mass. Let's carry that with us wherever we go. God bless.